Before we get started, I have just have to say that your face has no marks of a boxer. I mean, you must never get hit.
No, everybody says that I do. I just like have a good face in the way, like it can take a lot. So it's like everybody thinks I really take care of myself, but it's like, no, my face is just pretty hard. Yeah. Like I had a scar. You can barely see it, but I had 20 stitches put in last year at this time.
Headbutt?
Yeah, from a headbutt. It was multiple headbutts.
Wow.
So like, but it cleared up nicely. You can't even tell it's there.
Yeah, you can't see it at all.
Yeah.
All right, we're good to go here. Hello, everybody. Welcome back. It's Sam again and Tom. Hola from Madrid. And we are, of course, across the way, but as always, close like this, virtually.
Always.
And just a couple of guys on the corner just talking about international sports. Sam, we're both dressed for cooler weather.
Yeah, well, it's fall time. It's got to pull out the fall wardrobe and stay cozy. But, you know, the weather's gorgeous outside here in Madrid. And, you know, we're still in a little bit of a lockdown. But you and I have, you know, fortunately, we're still able to walk around a little bit and get outside and experience, you know, that fall, that beautiful fall weather.
Yeah. And we are, I guess, officially into a holiday season around the world. We wish everyone out there good times, and you know, it's like no other holiday season. We hope you're safe and that your family's well and you can visit or be with them to the extent that you can. But I'm looking forward to our guest, because anytime, you know, you got someone who's laced them up and thrown and come away with an Olympic medal, Marlen Esparza has so much to talk about in her approach and you know, her Olympic performance and so many other interesting issues. I'm looking forward to talking to her.
Yeah, I mean, boxing is a sport we've kind of covered a little bit before.
Absolutely.
With Klitschko almost a year ago. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, you can talk a little bit about the qualifiers and how important of a role that is here at the channel leading up to the Olympics and the qualifiers that we show live here.
Looking forward to that.
And then right now, just launched on our channel, is our latest original film, Mariah, A Boxer's Dream, a 16-year-old boxer, a Navajo boxer to be specific, who's 16 years old right now. And she's looking to become the first female Native American to qualify for an Olympic Games. And she's targeting Tokyo. So, or no, sorry, she's targeting Paris.
Yeah.
So boxing, it plays a big role here at the channel. And Marlen will continue, you know, that trend for us.
Yeah. I mean, for those of you who've watched us over the last year, you know, the corner, we dusted up a little bit, and I know Sam would like to get in the ring and, you know, take some shots at me, but I mean, you know, I'd go left, 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 right, body, and then I think they'd carry me out and body surf me around a packed arena.
Yeah, you just won't find me in a ring anytime soon, so let's just play.
I will say that if you get me to the second round, I won't be able to breathe. You know, you mentioned the boxing qualifiers, which are, you know, one of the casualties. We were, what, about a third of the way through in the beginning of 2020 when the pandemic hit. So they're going to wipe that all away, and they're going to go back to square one. And it's on for so many young people around the world who are dreaming of making an Olympics, walking in opening ceremonies. And, you know, I'm interested to see, from Marlen's perspective, you know, what's the mindset of the boxer who was trained and gotten ready for, what, 8 months ago or 6 months ago, and now they have to recycle and reboot, and, you know, it's so much of a mental battle.
Yeah, well, and the African qualifiers went through, and then the pandemic stopped at the European qualifiers in London. So
right.
We still have the American qualifiers in Buenos Aires and tentatively, and then the Asian qualifiers as well.
And, you know, once an Olympian, forever an Olympian. Once you make an Olympics, you are forever an Olympian. But she's in an even smaller category. She's an Olympic medalist. Mm-hmm. And I'm interested to see, I want to know where the medal is and all those kinds of, you know, things. You know, really excited about bringing her in. And
the last thing I'll say is, let's not forget, London 2012 was the first time women were women competed at the Olympics in boxing. So it was a pioneer event for not only the Olympics, but the sport in general. Right. So, you know, I want to add that. And, you know, she's a pioneer in our sport. And I think that is, you know, something that we should all be very proud of her to be like that.
Yeah. And if she's not a native New Yorker, she's now a New Yorker. And so, you know, it's kind of like my people, you know.
Yeah.
All right. You want to just do this?
Let's go.
Let's throw. She is a pioneer, an Olympian, a medalist, working to raise consciousness in her community, and probably she'll tell us, most importantly, a mom. We are so delighted to welcome Marlen Esparza to the corner. Thank you so much for taking some time. And am I right? Like, mom is number one, obviously.
Yeah. People don't see it all that way because it's so new, but definitely number one.
So take us through what your adjustment has been. I mean, this year has been different for all of us, way different than anything we've ever gone through. You know, troubling and scary. I don't know if you've had loved ones who have been affected by the virus, but just can you put this in perspective and sort of introduce us to what your year has been like?
Yeah, it's been a difficult year for me as well. I think a lot of everybody, and my life was kind of off because I had a ending of my last year was pretty crazy, and I was trying to keep the momentum in the beginning of this year. So I was actually 7 days away from a fight, and then everything got shut down. And I went from being in the gym 2-3 times a day to being at home, just at home with my son. And it became, at first I was like, oh, I can handle this because I don't get to see my son all the time. There was a lot, like, it was a lot of fun for me. But then after a while it was like, well, I don't know what else to do. Like, as far as we can go walk 3 times a day or how to like stay entertained for myself and for him. And then it started getting depressing after that point, where it was just like, well, I didn't know what was going on with the boxing. I didn't know if they were going to open anything back up. I didn't know, you know, basically where my career, what was going to happen with me at that point. Really just thinking, well, if I'm going to have to make it through an entire year. And it was really hard to deal with. Then everybody, slowly and surely, people around me who I know well, started to get sick. Luckily, I didn't have anybody around me who passed away, but I did have, you know, my dad was really sick for a while, which was scary. And it just became kind of, it was surreal, but it was definitely a difficult year. It still is. People are still on edge about what's really gonna happen. You know, with the election and everything, that now it's like, okay, we're trying to figure out our footing as a whole, as a country. I'm always in my head about stuff, and I was really, really on the brink of kind of just saying, well, I don't know if boxing's even going to work out for me because of this pandemic. And I had came off a loss, so I really needed to secure a win, and I wasn't going to get that outlet this year. So a lot of me was kind of worried about if it was even worth doing. And I think that was kind of my biggest struggle from the middle to the end. And I decided to just continue doing what I was doing. And sure enough, it worked out. So I think that was my biggest like moment where things were starting to mess with me.
I just want to talk about is there any silver linings? Is there any new outlook on life that you have had, you know, as we end 2020 per se, and kind of, you know, there is a light at the end of the tunnel that the world is kind of seeing right now?
I realized that I needed to really have more of a routine that was based around my son versus it being based around career. So it was like all the time that I spent with him, and I started to realize that all, like, how much he was learning and how much we were doing, and that there was so much more that I could put into versus, oh, gym, which is always necessary because it is, you know, my passion, but also my career. But it's a focal point. And I think that now with the pandemic and a lot of people losing a lot, and I think they're starting to losing people, you know, whatever it might be that they were working for, I think they can realize now that it's not always the most important thing. Whatever they thought was important isn't always the most important. And I think that's kind of the silver lining, that people are realizing we need to look after each other a lot more than we realized. And I think a bit more empathy. And that's what I see whole on whole.
I kind of want to maybe take a step back a little bit to, you know, a different time, 8 years ago almost, which is London 2012, a happier time, and hopefully it's crazy. And just kind of get your, when you think about London 2012 and those opening ceremonies, that moment of that so few people get to experience, can you just describe that surreal experience for us and for our audience?
Yeah, I would definitely, like, out of all my life and even at the games, that was number one, the biggest shocker or emotionally. I felt it was overwhelming in a good way. I'd never felt overwhelmed, but with happiness and like energy. But yeah, it was crazy. So it was my first time at the games and most of my teammates. So we were kind of just didn't really know what to expect. And you see the arena when you're walking towards it because they have everybody line up from the village and you walk. And you walk with other countries and, you know, other sports. And you see the arena, but you really don't know what the hype is about. You know, you hear noise, but you're like, well, I've been in an arena before. It can't be that crazy, you know. But once you walk in and you go onto the field and everything just opens up and you finally get to see it, it was the craziest thing that I've ever seen in my life. It was so many people and so many lights and so much going on that everybody looked like little ants. Like it just looked like ants, like with like flashes everywhere. And you have like, you have all the other teams and everyone's going crazy and everyone's like, oh my God, we're at the Olympics. And I think that's really where it's like everybody's true happiness about actually making it that far comes out. And it comes out very nicely because even though you're at the games and you already know you made it, there's not a lot of time always to enjoy it and sit there and be happy because you still have to win again. So, you know, everyone's goal is still to medal, podium, gold medal. And it becomes hard to even embrace and be happy that you're there. But that was really the energy. It's just like everybody for like that hour, or whatever it might be, was actually able to just enjoy the fact that they're at the games with so, it's just the craziest thing. So much energy, so much love. All of a sudden, it doesn't matter what sport you are, what country you are. It's just like everybody's at the Olympics. And it was definitely it was something that I can't really even put into words. It was just so much, like so much greatness, like in one place.
So in that moment, you know, the sort of stereotypical, oh, Olympic spirit, love, you know, the world, but it really became real.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what it is. It gets to become real and you can actually enjoy it versus just the idea of it, like you're actually experiencing it. And that's what it feels like. And everybody's still happy when they leave, but the whole idea changes back to the way it was, you know. Right. It's like, okay, well, we got to win again, you know, back to focus. But it was really an idea of that. Yeah, the whole, you know, uniting and everybody just, you know, loving and being appreciative and happy and just being able to represent your country was definitely like all the feelings that you get there. Plus all the love and support that you're getting from everywhere around the world. Like now you have other people from, you know, wherever country they might be from there to support, but they're also supporting you when they don't need to. And it's just really, it's a good feeling.
Okay. And London awesome. London was a special one, and the Olympic Stadium was new. And I mean, they put on a show, and it was a good one.
It's incredible, absolutely. Okay, so you said, you know, then it ends, and you pivot back to being, you know, the gladiator. You're there on a mission, and so now you got to get back into training mode and back to combat in a sense. Can you walk us through, you know, the qualies and then, you know, the medal rounds and what if your confidence must have begun to build as you moved on. And all of a sudden, as you moved on, you're like, not only can I medal, I may win the gold.
Yeah, no, it's, that was really the idea. I'm big on the idea of meditating and trying to see what's going to happen. And I really was already at a point where I was nervous because the competition, especially for that time, it was the first time women's boxing was ever in the Olympics. Right. And it was the first time that you really had a bunch of support for women's boxing. I think that even in 2016, there was not nearly as many fans. So it was packed every day. Like all the tickets were sold out. And for women's boxing, that's crazy. We were like all of a sudden it went from we didn't matter to we're the most important sport at the Olympics. So everyone was like, women's boxing, because it was new. So there was all that hype behind it. And then you have all these girls that we already know each other.
Right.
So it's not like, oh, I've never seen you before. Like, we all are very familiar with each other. So you have, I think, there were 16 girls, and every single one of them was really good. And you're just like, man, I wonder who I'm going to pull. Like, everybody's trying to figure out the brackets before the brackets are even made, which is impossible to do. And you're just really trying to hope, well, if I get this person first, then I for sure I could beat this person. And it's just like this whole idea of how am I going to get this done? And then when the brackets came out and you realize who you have to fight, or I realized who I had to fight, I was like, okay, yeah, I can win. I just had, you know, I was like, there's some issues here and there that we've been working on all camp. So I am definitely going to get a gold medal. And that was really my mindset. I didn't want to think any different way or any other way than that, because I wasn't trying to hit a moment in the boxing ring where I say, well, I already knew this was going to happen, so I'm okay with losing. And once I made it into the medal rounds, I was extremely excited, but I was trying not to get too excited because I didn't want to settle. I was like, no, I still want to go medal. So I think it was that too, the idea of like, at the end of the day, you're like, man, I still get to be on the podium. So at the Olympics, and that was really, that was really gratifying, period. But it's just the idea of I want to win, and I need to secure this medal for myself, for the country, and, you know, for women's boxing. Plus it was like the thing to do at the games is to be there. So it was huge on my end for being the first time. It was massive.
Yeah. And clearly you know, it happens in real time. You're numb. How long did it take, you know, you're on the podium and you see, you know, you got the bronze around your neck. Like, how long was it before you like, wow, not only am I an Olympian, I'll forever be known as an Olympian, but I'm a medalist in the first time sport for women?
It took a while, actually. I still wasn't, like, I still was just about competing the entire time. I didn't really celebrate besides at the opening ceremony. And then it was a bad time to hit me, but it was actually my first fight walking out, because I didn't realize how big. I realized the stadium was big. I had heard that it was sold out, but I didn't realize how huge it was gonna be. So when I walked out to go to my fight, my very first fight, I was like, oh my God, I'm at the Olympics. Cause it was the craziest thing. And I was like, oh my God. And I was like, had like a freak out moment. Cause I was like, okay, you have about 30 seconds to get it together from here to the ring. Cause it was like, oh no, I'm at the Olympics. What'd I do? So it was like freaking out on that end. But then once everything started to get together, it was good to know, and it was a good feeling. And once I won the medal, even though I was on the podium, I was upset about the loss, because it was a 2-point loss. Oh. And it was a really close fight. And it was like, did I edge it out? Did I not edge it out? And it was like,
did you think you won? Did you think you won?
I thought I had won. Yeah, I thought it was a 10-10 break, and I was going to win off throwing more, which is what I had thought. So I lost on 2 points, and it was like, I was still upset during the time of the podium. So when I got home, and I, you know, being the first, and I did have, was really blessed with endorsements. So I was basically everywhere. That's awesome. On TV and on, you know, at home. So when I got home, the welcoming was so crazy that I realized, wow, like, everybody knows that I went to the Olympics. I thought it was just like my life, not everybody was invested in me. So it was around that time where I realized that I was like, wow, like, I really, I kind of did something, because it was just overwhelming with the amount of support and stuff that I got when I got home.
Like, I'm a superstar, right?
So I left, and I left, and it was like, okay, you know, 20 people saying, you know, good luck. And then I come back, and, you know, the whole city stopping. So it was a change, and it was made me feel good for women's boxing too. I think that was always big to me.
Right. Can you just talk about, you know, you realized it once you got back, but, you know, just talk about the pride of wearing the Team USA colors, the uniform, the first time women's boxing is at the Olympics, a medal is, you know, has been, as has been discussed, but just, you know, representing Team USA on the biggest stage of your sports history, what that meant for you?
You know, it meant a lot to me, and I became a huge super USA, Team USA person when I was like 16. And it was because I didn't really get the idea of, you know, camaraderie and, you know, your teammates and your country and the representation of your country and what it means to love where you're from and represent where you're from until I had traveled out of the country for the first time. And I was 16, or I just turned 17. And they took me to India, they took me to New Delhi, India.
Wow.
So I went from never leaving the United States to going to New Delhi, India. So you can only imagine the wow. shock, yeah. the culture shock that I had. And I was a kid. I didn't know anything.
Like opposite culture, see what that is.
Yeah, you go to Walgreens on the street and you can read books and see all the pictures you want. But once you're there, it was just such a different idea. And, you know, it was just, I was for the first time realized, like, I am so, so happy to be an American, to fight for Team USA. And, you know, I really did feel blessed to be from America. And I think that was started when I was younger. And since I have stayed on Team USA my entire life, it only got bigger. So the whole, a lot of girls wear boxing headbands. A lot of them now, they don't know where it started, but they wear the American ones. It's like a thing when you're trying to win nationals. A lot of the little girls, everyone wears American flag headband. Well, like I started that because of my pride for the United States. So now it's a thing, but before it wasn't, and I added on the socks. So the whole idea being to represent my country and the team, I love Team USA stuff. Like, look, I even have like a Team USA pen right here. Like, I have Team USA everywhere. I love Team USA. I'm a huge supporter for anything Team USA, and I think that's really that I got to actually do it, and I got to live that sort of life for a while. It means a lot to me because of all the pride that I do have from being here.
Yeah, well, I have Team USA colors on too, so it's that pride is still here too.
Well, all right.
But I want to kind of talk about something. You know, you were in the spotlight. You did get a little publicity leading up to the games. It was on CNN, Latino in America, like a look up to, you know, upcoming boxers, and they highlighted you as a you know, someone that is going to be representing America in a sport that will be, you know, in the Olympics for the first time, and pride of kind of multicultural, you know, carrying two cultures. And can you just talk about that and kind of that experience and the filming, you know, breaking barriers and inspiring the next generation? Because, you know, I watched it and, you know, it is an inspiring piece, and that's what the Olympics and that's what sport is inspiring the next generation and breaking down those barriers.
Yeah, no, definitely. At first, I didn't understand what the big deal was, because in my head and my world, my world before everything, it's like everybody had told me growing up, boxing wasn't really going to get me anywhere. You know, women's boxing isn't something that's ever going to, you know, I'm never going to be able to live off of that. It's not a real dream. It's something you can do on the side. So after so many years, we get into the games and I'm here now and I've been winning and I'm ready to go, kind of. And I didn't think ever in my life that anything like that would happen. So they did approach me with CNN, with Soledad O'Brien, and I'm a very introverted person, which I've learned through this, through sponsors and through just networking. I've learned to be a little bit out of my shell. But at that point, I was like, wait, what? Why do you want to follow me around with cameras? Like, I'm not really. And they're like, well, you know your story. And I'm like, what story? I just box. Like, I don't get it. And they're like, yeah, but you're Latin and you're a girl and you're a boxer. And, you know, this is new and it's a really exciting story. I'm like, it's not that exciting. I'm like, I go to the gym every day and I come home first. It's not that big of a deal. And it became that whole idea of like, okay, people actually want to see it and know about what I'm doing, because she won a bunch of awards off that Latino in America. And then after that, I was with Nike. then it was like CoverGirl, Coca-Cola, and then Procter & Gamble. And it was just like, wait, so, and then they were just, it was just a thing. And I started to realize through that, through the filming and the clips that they actually wanted me to say, how they wanted to introduce it. And it was all very, it was always well done. And I started to realize like, oh, wow, like now I get why people were so interested in it and why it did matter or why it was so different. And I think that was the idea of it, period. And it still trickles on. So now, because I'm not a little kid and I'm an adult and I can kind of learn to use what I have or what I know to kind of help everybody else or help young girls or help, you know, somebody next to me who needs what I know. I think that's the whole idea of I can kind of use what I know and help everybody else trying to figure it out.
That's amazing. Tom, before you go, I just want to say that it just came out on the channel, and this is something that I think you can, appreciate, is we are just publishing a new film, a 15-minute film here on a 16-year-old Navajo boxer.
Yeah.
Who's aiming to qualify for Paris.
Paris.
He's won everything. And it is, and when I watch it and when we were prepping for this, I was thinking of the similarities of not only wanting to, not only to potentially be the first female Native American at the Olympics, but just the trendsetter and the pioneer that she's leading on in a sport that you did the same, 8 years ago and, 10 years ago. And so it's, just kudos to you on that front.
Yeah, that's tremendous. And what's your son's name?
Saint. His name's Saint, like the Saint. Saint Diego. I love that. Yeah.
That's awesome. So as you raise him, clearly challenging times, you mentioned it in the beginning, the U.S. is going through, it is, it's a searing change right before our eyes on a lot of levels. And it's also a time when it's important that people speak out or act out or, follow their inner truth about what's important, especially when you're raising your son. So how do you put in perspective sort of what's going on in our country, not the pandemic, but all the other stuff, as you parent your son? I mean, I know it's early for him and you're not, there's no messages yet, but as you frame, going forward and what's important to you to say to the world or as you model a way to lead your son forward in a highly divided country that needs healing now.
Yeah, when it comes to that, I really just want to make sure that he understands what he likes and what he doesn't like, what he's for. But ultimately, I want to give him a lot of morals and a lot of understanding that, the idea of judgment, I think, is huge on the reason that a lot of people can't see eye to eye. And the idea that not everybody's the same, and that doesn't need to bring hostility. It is what it is. They say you don't talk about money, politics, and religion with people, right? But I feel like if we did talk about it, maybe we wouldn't get so angry. There's things about just being open-minded and being open to people and ideas. And if I can just get him to understand, like, that's not different, or if it's different, doesn't mean it's bad. And people do a lot of things their own way. And to not really hold resentment is really my thing. So it's not really like do this, do that. It's about giving him an idea of how to view things in a positive, open way, and not be so closed off. Just because me and you do something a certain way doesn't mean that that's how it has to be done. Right. And I think if he can understand that, then as he grows, he can make his own judgments and assessments on what he sees as fit or how he wants to live his life, but also understanding that there's a lot more ways besides his way. And I think that's really just the idea that I want him to have.
And how will you, obviously growing up in with your background and, being a minority in the U.S., and I'm sure you've faced, are you kidding me, moments where people, they don't treat you well, they don't treat you as an equal. How do you get him through that? Or how do you politely, softly steer him through, the things that may be said to him? Maybe now we all hope that the world's a better place, but it's a reality.
I think what I was always helped me is that I don't ever know how someone was raised, and I don't ever know what they're going through at that moment. So if someone does say something to me, you know, hopefully catch me on a good day, and I don't, you know, it doesn't take me too long to rip to see, because you know it happens. Some days I'm a lot more bothered than others. But from the end, what actually gets me through is like I don't know how you were taught, and I don't know your mindset, and I don't agree with it, and I'm pretty sure I know you're wrong, but it's just the way that you're wired, and that's really not like your fault. How you got there, I have no idea, or what kind of day you're having, right. I don't know, because I've been a lot more unpleasant on one day than the other, and I just try to remember that at the end of the day, they're just humans, and not everybody knows what they're doing or why they're doing it. And you have to just realize that everybody's shaped and wired differently. And that's really how I try to focus. Like, you don't know what you're doing right now. So I'm gonna leave it alone. Like, people don't really understand all the time what they're actually letting out into the world.
That is a great mantra for all of us. And I will say, I'm often, all the time, I'm very mean to Sam for no reason. I'm just mean to him. Sometimes I just don't like him.
I go
but I always love him.
Or I stay in my room and cry. I cry basically right here, actually.
No. We go, believe me, he gives as good as he gets. He kicks me about, he'll bring up age, you know, which is a little bit of a little sensitive thing there. But anyway.
But yeah, no, I mean, as we kind of wind this down and kind of switch back to boxing as a whole, just kind of, you know, the qualifiers are coming up again, you know, the Olympics will be here before we know it. You know, there's a lot of big fights professionally going on right now. Can you just talk about the current state of the sport from, you know, the men's, the women's, and kind of what you see of it moving forward and the potential?
You know, women's boxing is doing really, really well. There's no die out. The momentum stayed really strong. So instead of, before we had only 3 weight classes, right? So now we have 5. So they added 2 more weight classes in for the women, which is awesome, which means that the field of women is only getting bigger and the competition is only getting harder. And, you know, also for women's boxing, now we have, you know, a few champions that are being televised. You know, you have that pool of women that came out of the Olympics and turned pro, and they're starting to really make a name for themselves and get on TV. So you have, for the majority of big cards, they have at least 1 women bout. And it doesn't sound like a lot to people, but that's huge. Before even the idea of a woman's bout on any card being televised, it would be, people would be like, that's impossible. You can't waste money on a slot for women. And on top of that, a lot of men who weren't boxing, women's boxing fans, were super against it. And they're already starting to change their minds. Right. So they don't like all of the women fighters, but I don't like all of the men fighters either. Just depending on what you like. You know, it's like, they're like, well, we don't like all women. This girl's not as good as this girl. It's like, yeah, there's a lot of guys that aren't that good either. So we don't like watching them either. It's the same difference. And I think that's what's getting more exciting is the little girls are still boxing too. So now you have gyms that have nothing but women. So you're talking about girls from 7 years old all the way to like 25, 30. And it's packed, you know, and it's all girls. And I've never, with women trainers. And it's just like, wow, like everything's definitely evolving. And people are really starting to open their eyes that there's talent. And if we're talented now, and you have a little girl who's 7, 8 years old, and if she continues training like many fighters have, like the field for women and the potential that we have is going to be crazy. So I think we're on a good track, and, you know, everything's looking good for us so far.
Yeah. I think Tom has one more, but just a quick follow-up for that one. And that kind of ties in what, you know, what you have been featured in on the Olympic Channel before, and that's Hitting the Wall. You know, you see all these young girls to, you know, women training in these full gyms, like you say, but also it's introducing a whole new generation and group of people to the physical demand that boxing takes on your body. Can you just talk about that demand and what people don't see and kind of the excitement it is when you have to introduce that so people realize how hard of a sport it actually is?
Yeah, no, it's definitely a very, very demanding sport, physically and mentally. But physically, people don't see. They're just like, oh, you fight, and that must be scary. It's like, yeah, but it's a lot more painful, like, on my body than it is as far as, like, being afraid. So, yeah, there's just so much that needs to be done to keep up with your body and maintenance. And I think that's one thing that a lot of people don't realize, and even fighters, that's a very old school sport. So you have all the other sports who understand that regardless of what they're doing, they still have to put time in to recover themselves. And because we're such a poor man's sport, I think that's kind of the biggest thing, and why a lot of fighters say, oh, you know, when you're 30, 35, you're old, you're too old for boxing. And it's like, it's a lot of people don't maintain themselves correctly. Right. And that's the key for us, that people need to realize that they need therapy, and us too, and probably need a cheaper way to find out what we can actually do. Like, even ice baths, like, it's not expensive to do an ice bath, but everybody thinks, oh, if I do therapy, I have to go to a doctor's office, I need to see a chiropractor, right, like, I need a physio. And it doesn't always have to be that way, but I just think the idea of little girls, young boys, every athlete that's in this new generation needs to realize that, because nobody talks about it, that they need to take care of their bodies, and we're not that advanced yet to really know, like, any other sport.
Right.
That's those are wise words. Believe
at
me,
Tom's, for those at Tom's age, he has to take care.
Yeah,
of his body
for those
extra
of us. Yeah, I mean, ice bath, not so much. I wouldn't be caught dead in that. That scares me. But I just had another knee surgery. Basketball is taking a toll, and, you know, but I wouldn't have given it up for anything. You know, I value those years in high school and college. But will Saint be a boxer? Or are you going to steer him clear? I know you want to let him do what he wants to do, but what's Mom going to think?
Yeah, and that's it. Everybody says that. So when are you taking him to the gym? I'm like, he's not allowed in the boxing gym for a very, very, very long time. Right now, he's such a baby that I fear that if I do introduce him, then it's like I'm basically pushing it on him, right, because he doesn't have a way to choose really anything. So I'm really going to wait, and I'm going to introduce him to a lot of different sports at one time. And I'm going to try to avoid the boxing at all costs. But if for some reason he tries, you know, anything from baseball to even piano, but he just wants to box, well, I'll let it happen, but I'm really, really hoping that he doesn't like boxing. Or it's just like, all right, your first day, you're going to spar. And I hope maybe he gets beat up and he doesn't want to come back. Like, I really don't want it for him. It's, you know, it's such a difficult sport. Yes. And especially with school, you know, boxing doesn't have any programs to where you can box and go to school.
Right.
So I just feel like going a different direction, like baseball or golf would be cool.
Yeah, it would be. Sam, are we ready for this, that, and why?
We are. It is time.
All right. TT&W. This is where we fire things at you, and you give us a thoughtful, off the wall, whatever answer you want, because the questions might be a little peculiar. But we'll start out. You know, you've been involved in film now, and so my first one is, again, this is old school, but I think you've probably seen or heard about, well, Rocky or Raging Bull?
Rocky.
Why?
Because I don't know what Raging Bull is.
Oh! Oh! I've been aged. Oh, no.
Sorry.
I'm going to cry.
I don't know what it is. Wow. I don't watch a lot of TV, if that helps.
That's very,
a lot of, like,
that's very healthy. Okay, good one. That, you knocked me out.
I'm in. Let's go with.
You told me to put Raging Bull in there. I was going to say Creed or something, but
don't
Sam,
this, don't
Sam
throw
walked
this one
me
on,
right into that right hand.
Don't throw this one under. Boxing or UFC, and why?
Boxing. I don't understand UFC. Like, my coach is a martial arts coach too, but I just don't get. I don't get it. I get boxing. I don't get it.
That's awesome. Okay, so you're in the ring, big bout, huge, against someone that you don't like much. They've been talking a little too much, or you just don't like them. Would you prefer a first round 10-second KO, or would you like to, you know, beat on them a little bit for three or four rounds and get a TKO?
I'd like to beat on them for 3-4 rounds. Yeah.
Yeah. I thought you might say that.
Yeah.
Punish them just a little.
Yeah, it'll help. It'll help. I'd definitely prefer that.
Speaking of the opposite, the first round knockout, there's a big fight coming up. Tyson or Roy Jones Jr.?
Oh, Tyson. Easy. I think Roy Jones is already afraid. Like, he's already, like, regretting the choice. And Tyson still fights like Tyson. And I think and he's strong. He's in shape. And it's crazy. So I think Tyson.
Sure. You see the photos of him are the ones that came out the other day of
Like, wow, you took this serious. Like, you were not playing around. It's cool to see him like that, you know, because he's gone through so much. But it's like, wow, he's ready. So
Roy Jones Jr. was an incredibly talented, but when you get hit by a hook from Tyson, it changes your religion a little bit, I think. Not that it's ever happened to me, but
it was amazing. I mean, I was saying to Tom before, the fact that Tyson hasn't fought since 2005 is also shocking. Like, it's 15 years, a long time.
Yeah. All right, last one. Olympic gold medal or a world boxing title?
Wow. That's hard. I guess the old me would have said gold medal, but the new me says, world boxing title for sure.
Why? Is it more money? Would that lead to like a better near future if you win a boxing title? Or
it's to me, I never really think about the money, but definitely it would you generate in one sitting more money, but who knows what a gold medal could bring, you know? So really it's hard to, you know, compare that. But it's more of the idea behind the gold medal. It's like gold medals, they're awesome and they're the best and it's all you want. But then it's like anything else, you kind of graduate and there's a new thing to do. So in the amateurs, you graduate and the whole thing to do is to get a world title. Since I went to the games, since I've medaled, the only thing literally left to do is to secure a world title. And then I can say that's it. I've done literally everything that there is to do here. So I think with me, it's the idea of the like finishing the way I'm supposed to finish and really saying that, you know, I am who I say I am. And that's what a world title can secure me, some sort of satisfaction.
I love that. I am who I say I am. That is, that's very, there's a lot in those few words. As always, when we get a chance to sit down with Olympians and people who've come through all kinds of things, to be able to share some time with you. And, you know, I learned so much, and thank you so much for your honesty. I don't know, you said that you used to be at a closed book, but you dropped a lot of gold on us.
Yeah. I've been learning.
Yeah.
Taking practice.
Yeah. Good luck with Saint. I have three older ones now and it only gets better, but they never leave.
I hope we never leave.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Congratulations and best of luck going forward. And we'll have our eye on you for sure.
I'm fighting for a world title at the beginning of next year.
That's unbelievable that you have a chance to win the world title we just talked about.
Yeah. It was, like I said, so it was a crazy year and I was really concerned what was going to happen, but it usually takes it would have took me about 3 or 4 fights to get to a contender to even become a contender. But what they did was they asked me if I would take a fight. And I just had the fight October 30th. They asked me if I would take this fight with a girl who was 12-0 with 2 knockouts. And the winner was an eliminator. The winner would fight the world titleist.
Wow.
So it was like, it's kind of a bad idea coming off a whole year without fighting. And then my last fight, I had that headbutt. Mm-hmm. So people were really concerned about how I was going to look and if I still had drive for it. And she was an extremely difficult opponent. So me and my coach were just like, well, look, no time to be afraid now, you know, like, let's just do this. Cause it would basically catch me up the whole year. It was really risky. So I ended up winning. I won every round. I won by unanimous decision. Yeah. She like punches hard and throws a lot and she couldn't really hit me. So it was actually really, really good for how everybody sees me now. And because I won that fight, I'm set up to automatically fight the girl who has the world title. She has She's had it for 3 years now. She's from Mexico. She, you know, she has like 36 fights or something.
Wow.
I only have 8, so people are getting confused, but it's because the Olympic pedigree, you know, it's like
I can
move up quicker. So now, at the beginning of next year, probably January or February, I'm thinking February, then I'll go ahead and I'll fight for the world title. It'll probably be in Vegas or in California, but I know for sure.
Yeah, you don't want to fight in Mexico, right? You don't want to go to her turf.
No, no, we're not going to Mexico. Luckily, I have a big promotional company who's one of the main, there's 4 big ones and they're one of the main ones. So they have the control of not me having to go over there, luckily.
Okay, I'm going to ask what nobody should ask, but come on, it's everywhere in sports. What's the purse? What's the?
It all depends on how much we're fully going to make or where we're at. I'll probably be like 100 minimum, and then after that is when actually it starts, or it could be like 80 to 100 minimum, and then after the win is when it starts to really pick up.
That's
because
great.
You have to get that win first, and then once I become a world champion, then that's when it really starts to hit off.
Well, that'll take care of Saints college tuition right away, right?
Yeah, it's going to take care of a lot. Like, we need a lot of world titles. We need like 4 world titles. So yeah, it's definitely the plan. Definitely the plan.
Thank you for updating us. That's an important element. And it was great. Best of luck. We'll be following you.
Thank you. Thank you, guys. It was good talking.
Okay, take care.
Bye-bye.
Well,
that was fun.
Here we go. Yeah, I'm a better person for having had the chance to meet and talk to Marlen. And boy, what an inspiration. And I mean, across the board, just on so many levels, that was a lot of fun.
Yeah. I said it in the interview with her and then, you know, wrote it down here. But what I have is pioneer. An inspiration, you know, not only in the sport, but you know, what she's doing after it. And Saint has a good mother. That is for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. And she was so eloquent about, you know, the challenges that she's faced coming up and, how she, you really don't sense, I mean, like we all have bad days, but you sensed she was in a solution and not angry about, you know, some of the situations that I'm sure she's seen and understanding the way of the world, especially how divided the U.S. is. I mean, here, that was like a treatise on how to overcome things. And I love what you said, you know, you don't know if the person's insulting, you don't know the day they're having or their upbringing or, you know, it's such a, I don't know. It's just it's a good mantra for all of us.
Yeah. I mean, look, there's a lot of things go behind closed doors that we, you know, we don't realize in other people and we have a tendency to react and, you know, react to the latest news, react to the latest, whatever it may be happening in our lives. And I think, you know, different stages, we act differently. And I think that, you know, her answers or Marlen's answers were very much level-headed to kind of understanding the state of what the U.S. is. And it's, you know, probably a lot of what athletes are, right? They understand their platform. They understand the influence they can have coming up, you know, coming up on many different levels. And I think that is a sign of, you know, of a good, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? It's a sign of someone that understands their stature in the world of sport. And I think that, you know, it holds true.
It does. And you and I, we kid each other, but we never have harsh words. You're mean to me a lot because you know you say I'm a boomer. I don't know what that is.
No, look, we have good fun and we are very aware of sensitivity issues and we understand that, and I think that's kind of an IOC perspective, right?
Yes.
We are going to, you know, inclusion, stronger together, the hashtag that's been going on and that we stand behind, and you know, just going back to Marlen, you know, what the Olympic values and kind of how it influenced her.
That was a great answer, just about how she was blown away and how she really felt it, and she'd heard about it, but you know, when you feel it in that moment in opening, it's remarkable.
Yeah. So,
all right. Well, thanks to all the support people, Mark and Sarah behind the scenes, getting it all done. And, Sam, we'll do another one. I can't wait for the next time.
Another one coming up. And as always right now, we wish everyone, no matter where they are, happy holidays, staying safe and, you know, and they're with their loved ones and family when possible.
Yes, absolutely. Be well.